Councillor, would it be approved? I remind committee of the tree house a few months ago. Moving house to different positions around the development's perimeter is not solving the issue, it's just moving it. Flooding of the southern boundary onto and through Marshall Drive, Ruffer Lane and down Ashfield Road is a huge issue. I have seen these roads and it takes on the road of a river. This is even before the development is built. Residents feel their fears have not been fully addressed on this matter. The building compound has been muted to be a permanent feature on green space, but where? The compound will be one of the first things on site and one of the last things to leave. This could be a feature for 6 years. Therefore, this needs to be as far away from the south west of the site as possible, the northeast corner. And this needs to be a condition, which I know Gary has addressed just now. Several members of the planning committee walked at the site as I did, and the only access stood out. Although the highway authority don't have an issue with it, I, the town council and residents feel that this one, exit entrance from and onto a very busy A road that is to be shared by cars, cyclists and pedestrians, is a serious accident waiting to happen. There should have been some pedestrian access on off the site from somewhere else, and I realise the committee have their hands tied on this, but I want this to be, I want this serious concern to be on the record. Before summing up, David Wilson Homes are no stranger to Pickering, and their reputation is somewhat tarnished as they developed the old Rogers Nursery site in Pickering, only several hundred yards north of this site. Not all of their conditions have been fulfilled yet. The application was approved in 2011 with a community park to be handed over to the Town Council on 95% completion of house builds. We are now in 2018 and some of those houses have had three or more owners and Pickering still hasn't got ownership of their park. I believe that this development should be approved, but not tonight, and not until all these valid concerns are addressed properly. Therefore, I would urge this committee to defer until such time David Wilson Homes have come back to the officers with the right application.
Good evening. My name is Paul Littlewood and I'm the spokesman for the Heatherside Residents Association. Our members live around this site, so we have a key set of interests in how this turns out. Given that the application seeks to leverage the local plan sites document and to add weight in favour of approval, given that the inspection of the local plan will commence in just a few weeks' time, we really were surprised to see this one come forward quite so quickly for determination today. The council has spent much time, effort and money on the local plan, and making this determination prior to adoption of the sites document does risk undermining public confidence in the local plan and the planning processes. Given that the outcome today may also prove to be prejudicial to the examination in public, we have referred this application to the PCU and requested a call-in review. What appears to be hastily written, somewhat superficial officer's report does appear to skirt around many of the third-party representations that have been made. But even the concatenated list of objections has not been fully addressed in the report. Now, I can't attempt to address all of those shortcomings because I've only got a minute and a half left. So I'll try to restrict myself to some prominent matters. Since this application was first lodged, the number one issue on our minds was whether this site could be adequately drained and not become a flood and water runoff risk to properties downhill and to the south. Almost a year has passed since this application was lodged, and despite that being raised repeatedly as a high profile issue, with the numerous conditions from the various parties that Mr. Houston has referred to earlier, this matter appears to have been consigned to little more than a footnote and added in the dying hours to the proposed planning conditions. We assert this is not a matter to be dealt with under planning condition, but instead is a matter of primary importance in deciding whether this site is suitable for residential allocation. We were pleased that members during your site visit recognised the overlooking and the overbearing presence of two-storey houses on the southern boundary would be unwelcome. It was good to have the applicant accept that design point and to see them place some bungalows on part of that boundary. It was a shame though that they only chose to do a partial job on, as we've heard, plots 1, 2, 5 and 6 on the southern boundary on rising ground behind A row of three existing bungalows still has two storey dwellings perched on them. They've moved them a few yards back and they've moved them up the hill, but they'll still be dominant and overbearing in the immediate outlook of residents. To counter issues of overlooking, instead of just putting some bungalows in, the developer proposes an 8-foot-high row of hedges. That might offer some protection of privacy, but it also adds a whole new dimension to the issue of overbearing nature. How those hedges will be protected was part of a discussion that was included in the late papers. The agent behind me suggested that these would be covered by conditions, but they simply weren't included. I think I've run out of time, so I'll end it there. Thank you for your time.
We worked with officers to make a number of amendments, as you've heard tonight, to respond positively to concerns raised. The site is the council's preferred housing allocation in Pickering, within the now submitted site's local plan. The development will provide housing for first-time buyers, couples, families and older people. It will importantly provide 35%, 83 affordable homes on-site and has the full support of your housing officers. Yorkshire Water and the Environment Agency have been consulted twice. They have reviewed very detailed drainage and ground information submitted within the environmental statement and have never objected to the scheme. With regard to highways matters, the development fully meets the technical criteria required by North Yorkshire County Council, including the access position on Whitby Road. A key benefit of the development is the widening of the existing footpath along Whitby Road, providing benefits to all existing parents and children who use this footpath to walk to school. Great care and attention has been taken to protect the amenity of residents. On the western boundary, where the ground levels are very similar, all distances between properties are longer than required by up to 3 metres in places. On the southern boundary, we've located bungalows adjacent to existing bungalows in all but one area. In total, we are providing more bungalows than required by your policy. We have significantly increased the distance between properties on the southern boundary by up to 29 metres in places, which is a huge 8 metres longer than normal standards. We've also provided a landscape buffer along the whole southern boundary to screen views between properties. We therefore share your officer's view that the amenity of existing residents will be protected. The cross-sections and photographs you have seen in the late pages confirm this. With regards to plots 125 and 126, the ground level on the boundary with the existing properties are virtually the same. However, we're providing a huge 26 metres to 28 metres distance from existing properties. This is in addition to the landscape buffer, which will also screen views. We have looked to change plots 125 and 126 to bungalows, however the financial impact of doing so will result in the need to lose 3 affordable homes. Given the important need for affordable homes in Pickering and the lengths we have taken to protect the amenity of residents, we agree with your officers the right approach to ensure the delivery of much needed affordable homes. There are no objections from any technical consultees or your expert officers. The application fully complies with national and the council's own planning guidance. The development will also deliver a £1.4 million SIL payment, which can be spent on improvements to local education, community and transport infrastructure. If approved today, the applicant will seek to deliver new homes at the site within the next 6 months. Members can therefore be assured that the 83 much-needed affordable homes will be made available for local people as soon as possible. We respectfully request that you approve the application tonight. Thank you.
Yes, Chairman, there just one or two points I'd like to come back on from all three speakers, really. In the context of Councillor Joy Andrews' comment about the building materials compound, it's not, as I understand it, the area that's being proposed is not right on the northern boundary, but it's quite a way away from the existing residences. So I think that was the gist of the comment. In terms of the comments from Mr. Littlewood, Mr. Littlewood has made comment tonight about the impending commencement of the site document examination. In fact, Chairman, as far as I understand it, we still haven't yet been given a date for that, despite the fact we were promised a July date, having submitted the document prior to Easter. The planning inspectorate then have fallen down on their side of the bargain. So the earliest we're looking at for the examination dates to commence is the end of September and possibly even October. I'm getting the nod on my left here, from the day of contact. With that in mind, bearing in mind the amount of examination days that will then ensue, the inspector won't then be stamping the plan approved the following week. It will then be a question of a lead-in report time, and I suspect we may be looking end of year, early next year, before we've got the inspector's report, and then we've got to decide what we do with that inspector's report. So adoption has been kicked into the slightly, I'd say, long grass, but it's been quite irritating given the efforts that officers in this committee went to get the site's documents submitted. In the meantime, we've got a duty to determine planning applications, so we can't simply just turn around and say, well, actually, chaps, we're not determining your application because we're waiting for a plan that might be sometime next year before we've adopted it, see what happens. That isn't something that we can do, and it's not something that any planning authorities can do, and it's certainly not unusual that planning authorities find themselves in the position of having to make decisions on planning applications in advance of the plan. It is a plan-led system, but the reality is it takes so long to get plans through that you can't stop doing the day job business of dealing with the planning application. The objector also made reference to the planning case unit, mentioned the letters PCU. We are aware that there's been contact with planning case unit. That's not unusual. I regularly get contact from the planning case unit inquiring about applications that have been locally contentious and have been raised with them. The planning case unit has not asked for this application to be called in or stopped the authority from determining the application, but they are interested in the recommended decision. In any event, whatever happened tonight, I mean, if members were minded to grant approval, then clearly we can't issue a planning permission tomorrow because it would be subject to a Section 106 agreement in relation to all the detailed things, not least affordable housing. But that's the situation with the planning casework unit, Chairman. And in terms of the last speaker, who's made reference to 83 affordable units, the actual policy club point amount is 83.75 units, I think, or 65 units, I think it is. So that 0.65 would be a commuted sum of whatever the difference is between a transfer price, the market value of a two-bedroom dwelling in Pickering, and it's two-thirds of that in effect. So which we get to be advised on. The point that was raised, which is one that I was interested in, because this application has been put forward as a wholly, totally policy-compliant proposal in terms of your affordable housing, is that clearly there are issues with the development of this site. Issues relating to things like double line pipes because of the groundwater protection issue, undoubtedly there are costs associated with that, but we haven't been in possession of any costs from the developer because they're not arguing a viability. If we got to a situation where the loss of two-story dwellings on plots 125 and 126 meant that we lost, as you've heard tonight, three affordable units, then we would be looking for figures to justify that diminution in offer. Obviously that then is not so good from an affordable housing point of view, Chairman. That hasn't yet been put forward, but it's something that members need to be cognizant of if that's the way they wish to manoeuvre. Clearly those are key issues. I don't think at this stage, Chairman, there's anything else I wanted to raise from the Speaker's point of view, save for to point out that the list of conditions does include the landscaping condition. I think one of the speakers suggested that the conditions didn't. It does. The provision of the landscaping scheme, not just on the southern boundary but all across the site, requires a landscaping condition, and that would be required. The dilemma with any boundary treatment next to the northern boundaries of the bungalows on that part of the site in Marshall Way and Corley Drive was providing privacy, has the potential to have an overbearing impact. And it seemed to me that the latest scheme, which was proposing a soft boundary on that location, was preferable to a 2 metre high close board fence. But that's what was originally proposed, because it was a high fence. I don't know whether there is an ideal solution there, Chair, but if there was a need for a condition, it's there.
Are there any questions for the officer? Councillor Andrews. Yes, Chair. Rather strange that so many houses should come off. Should come off on a single access point. I thought that there was a highways policy that said that there was a limit to the number of houses that were allowed to come off from a single cul-de-sac. Is that policy still in force? How have the developers got round it?
I think the developers have got round it, Chairman. They'll try to get back to the layout plan for you there. But at the entrance to what would be the access onto the A169 is a single point of access which immediately splits into two distributor roads. The Highway Authority consider that to be an acceptable arrangement, so that if you got to a point where, sorry, I've got to go back through a lot of photographs, but if you got to a point where, for example, something happened close to the entrance, there would be a way of getting round the site for an emergency vehicle or other traffic. If there was a highway safety issue, Chairman, I mean, the Highway Authority has spent months with this, we would know about it.
I have to say, Chairman, I'm very, very surprised, because my recollection is that restriction on the number of houses you could have from a single access was rigid. It was set in stone. And it couldn't be changed. So
when was
it changed?
That's clearly not the case. We've got an extensive list of highway recommended conditions and observations in the committee report, Chairman.
When was the policy changed?
I'm not aware that there's a policy, Chairman. You have the Development Control Officer's comments from County Hall that access is safe.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The detailed proposal for this site said the development shall include pedestrian and cycle-only routes in and through the development to site access. I've not really seen any specific plans for any pedestrian cycle-only routes. Do they exist?
That you're quoting from the site document.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what the site document brief is saying, that this is the planning application that the Highway Authority have been asked to comment on and tell us whether it's safe for vehicles, pedestrians and cyclists. So I can't see on there any specific cyclist route. There's certainly separate pedestrian footways next to the roads. There isn't a bespoke cycle route within the scheme. But they have to look at that. I mean, this is... What we have there is the planning process. What we have here is a planning application. And we've got to deal with this planning application. So unless the Highway Authority are telling us that there's an inherent safety issue with that, then we're struggling with the planning reason for a planning application to take issue with it.
Yeah, it's very disappointing that there's no real regard taken to cyclists on this site, which brings me to another point that I really have serious concerns about routes off the site, the Service Councillor Andrews being a single one, specifically as there is no secondary pedestrian and cycle route off there. I've noticed that it's up to about 1.2 miles just to walk to the infant school, which is not a great distance away from this estate. And that would include two crossings of the main road. Now, almost inevitably, that will not force, but encourage members of the public with young children to take them in the car. Then you get to the same old point where they say, my kids can't walk to school, it's not safe because there's too much traffic, and that a lot of that traffic exists because people are in their cars. So, has any home-to-school safety assessment been conducted for the various schools in Pickering, infants, juniors and Lady Lumley's, but most importantly the infant school?
In selecting the sites, we went through what's called the site selection methodologies, and I'm not suggesting any of the sites are wholly ideal. But if you compare the performance of this site to the infant school compared with Firthlands Road on the other side of the western side, then you've got to come through Bibbis Lane. So locationally, the eastern sides are better for the infant school. Clearly, it's a bit quid pro quo in the sense that Swansea Lane is the other side of Lewis Lane, so you've got the counter argument. But I think this, what's important to state, I think Councillor Drew Andrews mentioned this earlier, is that this is the site that I think the town preferred. It was the best of the rest, as it were. And short of demolishing a property in Corby Way and Marshall Drive, how on earth would you get an access through to the school in the most logical, you know, as the line in the crow flies? And if we had, then I'd have the secure by design people telling me that that was a burglar's paradise for having a rear access out of the site for somebody to run away on. You know, none of these sites are ideal. They've all got their constraints. But in terms of the sites that we chose, and the sites that we put forward were the ones that were least visually intrusive in the landscape, which this one clearly is, you know, in comparison with others. The ones that had least impact on historic field patterns, which this one doesn't. And ones which were, in all other respects, reasonably close to the town. In delivering this scheme, that it does actually provide, because of what the Highway Authority are requiring, is enhancements to footpath links, for example, and crossing points across the road. I'm just looking at that plan now again, thinking, well, actually, there is a footpath link through the site from the Southern Distributor Road to the north that goes along the edge of the public open space. But it's not essentially intended to think as a cycleway, which I think was your question that you probably asked me as well, which goes from here to there, and then go all the way around there. But there isn't, I don't think, Chairman, there's an ideal here. This was the site that we, or one of the sites that we chose in Pickering, because it formed the best across a range of criteria. The process that it went through, and that's what this council agreed to submit, and that's what had the support of the local town council in principle. So dealing with the principle of the site selection methodology, you get involved in the nitty-gritty of the outline of the application when you get your planning applications. Armed with what the Highway Authority are saying, I think it would be very, very, very difficult, because they're the experts that we rely on to give us the advice. Nobody in this room is a highway expert.
Yeah, I understand all that, but of course it's not the job of the council to produce the best points or the ability to access and egress the site safely on the southern boundary towards the school. It's up to the developer to come up with a solution for that. And it's very disappointing that there isn't anything. And it's more than disappointing, because that creates a significant danger and an increase in traffic from people going to the infant school. And the first time somebody gets killed going across that road, especially young children, there's going to be repercussions, and unfortunately it's too late. But anyway, another question. I was interested to see that there were details of this hedge on the southern border that were only included in the late papers. And Mr. Littlewood alluded to the fact that this should be conditioned on ownership, access, ongoing maintenance and so on. Presumably there are going to be conditions around that hedge then.
Chairman, what's recommended in the late pages is what I would call a standard condition relating to the submission of all of the landscaping details for all of the site, not just the southern boundary. Clear that the southern boundary has got more challenges than certain other parts of the site in terms of species, maintenance, all of those sorts of things. We haven't specifically sought to deal with that in any other way than we would treat any details of any of the landscaping.
Final one. You were obviously satisfied that you'd got approval from IDB's environmental agency and so on regarding flood risk. But I noticed the IDB's recommendation, and I quote, requested substantial improvements need to be implemented by Yorkshire Water to existing treatment plants before any further major housing development was granted permission. So what's the timescale for these improvements, please?
The conditions, well, firstly, Yorkshire Water, aren't they internal drainage board or not Yorkshire Water? They do not deal with the treatment of foul sewage. The conditions that are recommended on the page 26, these late pages, are, I think there are four separate conditions from Yorkshire Water, which require separate systems for both foul and surface water, which is what we expect, made reference to further details in terms of the disposal of foul water, requiring details of their construction, requiring permeable liners. They also talk about details of the surface water disposal being submitted. All of these required before development takes place. So then I'm reading now conditions 14, 15, 16 and 17, which I think are the ones from Yorkshire Water. The timing of that is development dependent. So if we issue a planning permission, it's got a 3-year life to it. How quickly that's taken up is dependent on how quickly the developer sees the need to implement the planning permission. We've heard tonight the developer wants to get on this year and start doing this development, which would suggest that those conditions would need discharging fairly sharpish. But all we do when we grant a planning permission is grant a planning permission, and it has a time commencement on it. From if it gets permission today, it's got 3 years to be carried out in effect, and then permission lapses. But when it starts is in the hands of the developer. So I can't tell you when any upgrade, if it was required, would be carried out, because it's development dependent.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, it's somewhat disappointing that Yorkshire Water can, I mean, fair enough, they've put a lot of conditions in place, but it is definitely conditional on whether their existing treatment plant is capable of handling the extra amount of water that's going to come through, albeit attenuated. And as the final recipient of this water, the IDB's view that it needs substantial improvements based on their considered and practical opinion is again disappointing. So thank you.
Chairman, just very briefly, I think what you need to appreciate is that this is a planning application and a planning permission that's being sought for tonight. Planning permission doesn't replicate other legislation. There'll be all sorts of controls and consent required under the Water Resources Act, Highways Act for the works in the highway. This planning permission doesn't regulate that level of detail. So when we're consulting with a planning consultee, be it on an outline or a full application as it is in this case, we're asking those authorities to tell us, can they handle this? Can they deal with it? And they're all telling us they can deal with it. So in that basis, to object to this on highway grounds, to object to this on drainage grounds, it would be an unreasonable decision.
Councillor Ritz.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I'd like to make an observation that the agricultural runoff rate for water is at 4 litres per cent, so 5 litres per cent from this development isn't a great deal of extra going into the system. As for the picture you've got up there for access on the highway aspect, with one access point, I think that section 17 would be very, very much in favour of this in the place of grammar, that there's only one way in out on security alone. Would you agree?
Well, the police secured by design officer hasn't objected to this scheme. is the answer, but there are all sorts of levels of detail down to which site, which type of lock you put on the door of the house.
I don't know the key to the one access, I'm quite sure.
Councillor Shears.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I refer to the area of the other side of the site for Corby Way and Marshall Drive. It's proposed to put a hedge, is it? Behind the gardens of the bungalows and houses which are on those two roads, and they're quite close to the page anyhow. How far back will they, are there going to be bungalows again, actually on that site, or is it not, wasn't really quite clear in the application, the second things we've got in?
Are members able to
set back?
Are members able to see this red dot on the screen?
Yes.
Yeah, this is the southern boundary of the site, so you've got a big area of open space in the depression.
Yes. Yeah.
And then on the, then on the southeastern corner you've got another area of open space which actually underground is a big tank. So there's no development behind the back of this bungalow that I showed you lengthways.